Against Toronto, the Blackhawks have proven there is something to the home ice advantage. They win again here at the United Center by a final of 2-0. Eddie Belfour, the shutout, 17 saves.
Eddie Belfour did a great job. His entire team did a good job. They really did this one by the book. There wasn't any chink in the armor there for Vancouver to find a crack.
A night with a lot of emotion. Jeremy Roenick back in the lineup. We will visit with Jeremy Roenick of the Chicago Blackhawks after this victory. But right now, we need to check in with our good friend, Bill Pito. Good evening, Bill.
Hi, guys. Thanks a lot. Coming up on NHL tonight, two games in the West. We look at the return of Jeremy Roenick of Chicago, highlights and analysis from Barry Melrose and much more. It's all tonight, next on NHL Tonight. Bill Pito and Barry Melrose on NHL Tonight. It's great to have you with us. First up, Chicago and Vancouver, game number two. Roenick back for the Blackhawks for the first time since April 2nd. And a big thing to watch, perhaps the effect it would have on Dennis Savard, who has 7 points in his last three playoff games, and on Joe Murphy, who has a goal in his last five playoff games.
Yeah, I'm not concerned how Roenick's going to play. He's going to come out here and give all his heart. He's going to run into people. He's going to play very hard. He'll be shaky. He's missed 6 weeks. He's not going to be as sharp as he was. But it's the effect on Savard, who's been playing well, the effect on Murphy, the effect on Amonte. These guys have been playing great. They've been playing with a lot of fire. What's going to happen to them now? And you'll see Jeremy here, right here. They're going to be physical with them. They got to be. They got to test that knee out. That's the unfortunate part of this business. Guys that have injuries, you got to play hard against them. And Jeremy's up to the standard. This guy is a gutsy performer. I love this guy. He plays hard every night. He loves to play. He's a 50-goal scorer, but he's in the trenches night after night. And you see his stride here. Looks very good. Not skating with any limp or any semblance of pain.
Chicago won the game 2-0. We'll have highlights on that coming up later in the show. But overall, Roenick back, not much of an effect either way.
No, he was back and he did what we thought. He ran into people. He played very hard, but he was shaky with the puck. He didn't make any beautiful plays. Matter of fact, he made some plays. You could tell he wasn't quite in game shape yet. And the team basically played very hard. They played very well and continued. Vancouver's a team that's got to pick it up. They're playing with a lot of not much emotion yet.
One last thing on Roenick's return. He plays left wing on the second line. Savard, the center, and Amonte on the other wing. Interesting that Roenick playing left wing most of the game.
Well, Darryl's doing that so he doesn't screw up the lines he's got now. Savard's playing great center. Murphy's playing great where he is. He doesn't want to shake too many things up here and take away from those players that have been playing very well.
All right, we'll check in more on that series later on, but next up we have Detroit and San Jose. And the interesting thing about Detroit, they've won five of their six playoff games, and the big guys really haven't scored that much. Yzerman, one goal. Yeah. Fedorov, one playoff goal. Shepherd, two playoff goals. And yet the team, 12 for 34 on the power play so far in the playoffs.
That's why this team is so scary. Their fourth line guys are scoring lots of goals. The big guys aren't even contributing four or five or six goals like the other teams have, and they're still winning handily. So that shows how deep this team is.
All right, Detroit up, of course, one game to none against San Jose. Let's take a look now at game two, back to Detroit. And that's a picture of the last time the Wings won the Stanley Cup, 1955. 11 more wins to go this year, and they got it. Less than 2 minutes in, Yzerman to Coffey, one time at a bang, his 50th career playoff goal, 1-0 Wings. Then Coffey almost strikes again. Erbe back in the net, toe save. Sharks get themselves in trouble. Jim Kite, the cross check on Kozlov, it's a penalty. Coffey to Fedorov, one time, there's his second goal of the playoffs, 2-0 Wings. 3 minutes later, Yzerman, the great effort, gets a pass back from former Shark Bob Airy. Yzerman scores, 3-0 Detroit, Barry.
This looks great, and great players love the give and go. You see a man go to the net hard. Detroit's doing that very well. Little give and go. The San Jose player blows his coverage wide open net for Yzerman.
2 minutes later, the onslaught continues. Dino Cicerelli continues to play awfully well. Comes in front, beats Erbe, 4-0 Detroit.
Again, what's happening here, watch how hard Primo goes to the net here. He takes one player with him. He supplies the screen. Little wrist shot through traffic. Detroit's going to net very hard right now.
And off the faceoff, Vernon robs Ozilinch with the glove save. Second period, Wings trying for some more. Sean Burr, his shot beats Erbe, but oh so close, hits the post. Detroit then on the power play. Cicerelli to Yzerman to Fedorov. There they go again, 5-0 Detroit.
The big guns are starting to score. Yzerman and Fedorov, great play off the skate, good quick wrist shot. San Jose players a little late.
Then, late second period, this time shorthanded, it's Doug Brown. He's on the loose. Late in the second period, he's got a move and a goal. It's 6-0 Detroit.
Here's one of their penalty killers, a guy that's known for his defensive ability, toasts a goaltender on a great move. That shows how deep they are again.
Third period, more Vernon. Makes one save, and then covers up. Vernon seems to own San Jose. Boom is out in Detroit, and the broom as well. Kevin Constantine of the Sharks, his team in the past has come back from big losses. They didn't do it in this one as the Wings win it 6-2. They now lead the series 2-0. Fedorov, 2 goals, 1 assist. Yzerman, 1 goal, 2 assists. Coffey, 1 goal, 1 assist. Cicerelli, 1 goal, 1 assist. Detroit now 5-0 at home in the playoffs. 2-for-3 on the power play. Now in the playoffs, 14-for-37, an amazing 38% on the power play in the postseason. Mike Vernon, 15 saves in his career. 16-1-1 lifetime against San Jose. The one loss came when he was with Calgary. This year against the Sharks, look at the numbers. Vernon has been just about unbeatable. So the key to the game, Detroit's big players playing and scoring, Fedorov and Yzerman. And one note of interest is that San Jose went with Flaherty in the net. Urbe in the playoffs coming into this, a goals against of almost 5, a save percentage of only 84%, and yet Constantine went with him in game 2.
I think it was just a hunch of Kevin's trying to shake them up. I thought Flaherty was very good last game, 6 goals. You might as well try something else. But San Jose's got to score the first goal and start attacking Detroit a little bit more. But it was basically just a case of too much against too little.
One thing also that you were talking about, maybe it's coming too easily for Detroit so far.
Well, I'm playing devil's advocate here. If I'm Detroit, you're playing 2 series. You got by Dallas very easily. You're playing San Jose. You're going to beat them, looks like, in 4 straight very easily. What's going to happen when they finally meet a team that's going to play them very hard? Are they going to be able to respond? These are the goals that just kill you, these open net backdoor goals. You just see how talented they are. Shepard's a guy who was struggling, wasn't scoring, gets a gift like that. That demoralizes a team. And then you see here big Fedorov finally getting a score. That's a talented man to be able to do that on a one-timer shot off a hard pass. That just shows how great this team is. But things are coming too easy for Detroit, and when they play a Vancouver or a Chicago, are they going to be able to tighten up and battle nose-to-nose with those teams when they have to?
After 2 games, the numbers are all in favor of Detroit, as you might expect. Let's take a look at how it breaks down. Games 1 and 2, Detroit has outscored San Jose and outshot them 79-32. Now on the power play in this series, 5 out of 7, 2 out of 3 in this game alone. And as I mentioned before, Barry, 14 out of 37 on the power play so far in the postseason. More now on the game from the guys who called it, Tom Meese and Darren Pang. We'll check in with them later. But coming up, highlights of the story between Chicago and Vancouver, game 2 and much more after this. So stay right where you are.
If you do this, you need this. If you get these, you need these. Spyroflex abrasion, skin saver, and blister kits get you back in the action fast because Spyroflex helps you heal faster, reduces pain and scarring, and protects up to 7 days. Spyroflex abrasion, skin saver, and blister kits are now available at a store near you.
I'd like to tell you about my friend Jake. Jake is music. If he's not playing, he's listening to music. He has a legendary music collection. He's got stuff from last century.
8 tracks.
The best times we have are just when we sit down and pick up the guitars and play what comes to our heads. Jake's just a great friend.
Western. Got his backstage passes?
Yes. Everybody loves him. Not too sure the neighbors do, though.
When you're with a friend as good as Jake, shouldn't you have a Heineken?
Well, the battery's good, and the starter's brand new, so I figure it's got to be the alternator, right? I go into the AutoZone, get a new one. Well, this guy says, well, let's check the old one first. No sense buying something you may not need. Well, turns out it's a voltage regulator. I tell you, I could have spent a lot of time swapping out parts till I got it right. But with AutoZone, piece of cake.
Everyone knows water and wax don't mix. Everyone's wrong. Introducing Wax Packs, the revolutionary car wax that disperses in soap and water to wax your car while you wash it.
I'm waxing.
New Wax Packs, waxes while you wash.
One of the ways Ryder makes your move easier is with a computerized reservation system that makes short work of paperwork. Because the sooner you get your move started, the sooner you're finished. Ryder, we're there when you need us.
Tonight is the show. You hear the music, you see the times for Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, right here on the ESPN2 television network. As we told you and showed you at the top of the show, Jeremy Roenick made his return for Chicago Game 2 against Vancouver. Going back to the last five games of the regular season and counting the playoffs so far, Chicago has won 10 of its last 13 without its star. Highlights now of game number 2. And Roenick taking the ice for the first time since he got hurt April the 2nd. Roenick physical early, takes a run at Joseph Baranek right there. JR then sets up Savard, side of the net. McLean, though, makes the save. Former teammate Christian Ruutu takes JR's legs out on this sequence. And here we go. Scramble in front. Ronning open. Belfour makes the glove save, Barry.
Watch here now how Belfour uses his lower body to protect the bottom of the net, and his gloves pick up everything high. Most of the young goalies play this way now.
Some hitting again. You know, Ogic rides Joe Murphy. It's a long ride into the boards. Goes Murph. Chicago scoring first, Eric Daze stopped. Jim Cummins pokes on the rebound. His first career playoff goal, 1-0 Chicago.
I'm happy for Jimmy. He used to play for me. If McLean has a weakness, it's his feet. We always talk about throwing in his feet. You see, he has a little trouble with it there. Jimmy wins the battle with the defenseman in front and just knocks it in the net.
JR throwing the body at Jeff Courtnall here, then gets hit by Baranek. Roenick looked pretty healthy. 1-0 Chicago after one. Second period now, Roenick takes out Ogic away from the puck. Paul Stewart, though, calls interference. So, on the power play, Courtnall, Alume, Bure the slapper, but hold everything. Trevor Linden called for a strange interference call, nullifying the Bure slap shot there.
This is not why the rule is implemented. The rule is implemented to protect the goaltender who's interfered with. You see, Linden is touching the crease area, but he never once touches the goalie or interferes with him. That's very nitpicking as a call.
Third period, Craven. Oh, into the boards he goes, a former Canuck. Later in the third, Hawks 2-on-1, Poulin beats McLean, 2-0 Chicago. More Roenick now. He takes out Cullimore with a huge hit. Hawks win in another kind of blah game, as Barry was saying. Blah, 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 2-0 was the final score, but Chicago will take it. Ed Belfour, second career playoff shutout, 17 saves in the contest. Chicago 0-for-2 on the power play. They're just 3-for-32 in the playoffs, but yet they lead this series 2-0. Belfour now 6-0 this year against Vancouver, as the Hawks are undefeated this year against the Canucks. McLean 0-6 this year against Chicago. So Roenick returned, threw the body around, didn't have an impact on the scoring, but he's back in the mix for the Hawks. He talked after the game with Mike Goldberg and Brian Engblom.
Thank you and welcome back to the United Center in Chicago, where the Blackhawks victorious tonight in game 2 of their Western Conference semifinal series against the Vancouver Canucks by a score of 2-0. Mike Goldberg, Brian Engblom, and certainly tonight this was Chicago Blackhawks style hockey, defensive and physical, and emerging back in the lineup, and it was a good thing. Jeremy Roenick is downstairs to visit with us, and JR, you said you were going to make your physical presence felt, and you did so, partner.
Yeah, well, that was my first game plan, to go out and be physical, get the team energized with my physical play, and just try to play good defense, because I know my offensive skills might be off a little bit. But, I went out, I felt pretty good. I tried to throw my body as much as I could and try not to make too many mistakes. And, I felt pretty good.
Well, from the physical standpoint, JR, if you take a look at your monitor, I think we're going to see a couple of hits here. Maybe they'll come back to memory. I know you had quite a few out there, but when it comes to body contact, you're a guy in the open ice. You know exactly what you're doing out there.
Well, it was just had to be chance. I had the good play, and this is just on the boards, and Courtnell had the puck, and I got, just rubbed him off. It's not a big hit, but it counts. Just rubbing him off the puck, so that's just as big as a big hit. So it's very important. And here, this is all the same. Just rubbing them off the puck, make sure they don't get to our
defense. Courtnell was your buddy tonight.
Yeah, and this is just good open ice. He had his head down, and I caught him pretty good. So, that's what I love, and that's what I've been thinking about the last month and a half. So it was sweet to see.
Well, certainly it was a hero's welcome tonight for Jeremy Roenick back here in Chicago. And JR, there was a momentary gasp though when you fell in front of the net. You were tripped up on a stick and took a second to gather yourself, I think, and say, you know what, the knee's good. And I bet that was a good mental thing for you, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, that was on the power play. I got tripped up a little bit, and I had to use my bad leg to keep myself up, and I kind of second guessed it, but I was kind of really off balance. It took me a second to gain my balance again. So it was I was sitting in the locker room. I saw Barry Melrose said before the game he didn't think that I should have played, so I had to go out there and prove him wrong.
Well, JR, the easiest thing to get back is the physical part of it. How did the hands feel?
Oh, the hands felt pretty good. I was really impressed with the way they felt tonight. I felt like I had some good control of the puck. They shut our line down pretty well. We were playing pretty well defensively, and We didn't have too many odd man situations, but when we did, I thought we made some good plays. And
well, JR, thanks for being our guest, and it was great. I think every hockey fan was glad to see number 27, Jeremy Roenick, back in the Chicago lineup tonight. They lead the best of seven series, 2-0. Back to the studio.
Creating a storm, my partner here.
I didn't say he shouldn't play. I said pick the right time and get the most out of him coming back. He's a great player. I love him. He's one of my favorite players in the
world.
You're
backpedaling now, Barry.
But
come on, take the heat.
You could get more out of him if you bring him back at a better time. And as you said, he was great tonight. He did what we thought he did. We ran into people and stuff. But I thought the guys around him responded very well. Savard was still a factor. I thought Murphy was very good again tonight. And I thought Chelios and the rest of the team stepped it up. But Vancouver's got to play better. They're playing with no emotion. There's a team that played so hard against St. Louis, so emotional, that the intensity, they don't have that right now. They don't have that little extra that it takes to beat very good teams like Chicago. Chicago's got it, and they're still not as intense as they were against Toronto, but they're much more intense than Vancouver right now.
Chicago up 2-0. Much more coming up on NHL tonight. Coming up, we'll take a look at what's ahead in the East. A look ahead as the Rangers go home down 2-0 against the Flyers. Also, the Pens hope to put behind the misery of Game 2 against New Jersey. That and much more when Barry and I come back after this.
If you play ice, roller, or street hockey, then check out this special offer from Hockey Player, the magazine for those who play. Each issue is packed with what you need to get the most out of playing the world's fastest team sport. Interviews with NHL stars and coaches, playing tips from the pros, equipment reviews, conditioning drills, new products, and more. Dial 1-800-652-0101 to subscribe. Order with Visa or MasterCard and receive your free bonus gift, 101 Hockey Tips. This booklet is a must-have source of winning-edge hockey secrets. Subscribe to Hockey Player and improve every aspect of your game with special columns and departments for goalies, defensemen, forwards, coaches, and more. So whether you play on the ice or in the street, call 1-800-652-0101 and get ready to score. To subscribe, call 1-800-652-0101. A year subscription of 10 issues is only $15.95. Order now with Visa or MasterCard and receive your free gift, 101 Hockey Tips. That's 1-800-652-0101.
Morning, Mr. Engel. Checking to see you're stocked up for the extreme games.
I ordered some extra tube patch kits.
Mike King, Miles Rockwell, they're not school children riding with no hands. They're world-class athletes on $4,000 bikes. Dual slalom, dual downhill. Shooks has got plug-in, Engel.
Better get another gross of these, too.
Welcome back on the fly. Other hockey news, notes, and information. Hartford signs Robert Kron to a multi-year contract, and the Blues AHL affiliate will be Worcester for the next 5 years. Now look ahead to Wednesday in the East. Rangers go home down 2-0 against the Flyers. They've never before come back from being 2-0 down, 15 tries in a 7-game series. Big story for Philly so far, John LeClair picking up from where he left off in the great regular season. He's now got 25 goals overall with the Flyers in 38 games.
This is a guy, I know Lindros and I know all the rest of the Flyers, but this is a guy that's really surprised me. He's become a dynamic offensive player. Great play here. The three big men here, they're also huge. Making plays like this is unbelievable. But right here, look at the speed. This is like a European, a small European making this play. The goal is disallowed, but that's a great play from a big man like him. If I'm the Flyers, the one thing that I got to start concentrating on is stopping the Ranger power play. They've scored 5 out of their 7 goals in the power play. And you see right here, McTavish is running around too much. That's a set Ranger play, creating the backdoor opening. McTavish has to be more in control. Even here, when they're down 6-on-5, you see the Flyers are running around too much. They should all be around the net, looking to pick men up, not concentrating on the puck the way they are here. And they give up a goal in this situation. But it's the Ranger power play's got to be stopped. If the Flyers can do that, the Rangers are going to have a tough time coming back. And that's an unbelievable stat, never coming back two down in 15 tries. That's a phenomenal stat.
So the Rangers going home now, down 2-0. Brian Leetch obviously says, hey, we got to win game 3.
Certainly we thought we could win one in here, like I said, and we have it now, so we have to win game 3. There's really no point in looking behind or further than one game, and we're gonna go out and win that one.
I think we feel pretty good about ourselves right now, but we got a lot of work to do, and this team is not gonna be easy. I still think it's gonna be a real, real, real tough series. I mean, we're up 2-0, but it's a first team to 4. I wish it was a first team to 2, but it's not.
One thing to point out here, three Ranger forwards who played well against Quebec have struggled so far against Philly. Kovalev, Nemchinov, and Graves each scored four goals apiece against Quebec, but each is goalless so far against the Flyers. And this reminder, game three right here on the Deuce, Wednesday night, 7:30 Eastern time. The Rangers and the Flyers, all the action right here Wednesday night on ESPN2. Next up, the Pens and the Devils. Of course, Pittsburgh shorthanded defensively with Ulf Samuelsson, who will now be out games three and four with the bad ribs. Shel Samuelsson hasn't been 100% after all the stitches, the 60 stitches in his face. And as a result, Pittsburgh has to go with Taglianetti on defense in a critical sequence against the Devils in game two.
Well, it's not so just much Taglianetti. In that situation, Kel and Ulfie would have been on the ice. After Pittsburgh tied it up, they would have both been on the ice here. Watch this. It's tied up. Everything is in their favor for overtime. And Pittsburgh thinks it's going to be overtime. They think it's going to be a lock. Ragged doesn't play the puck properly. Taglianetti doesn't do his job. It's a soft goal. Right here now. Steven should be held up. Ragged should control the rebound or put it to the side. Taglianetti should have Steven. They all fell asleep on the job. They thought it was going to be overtime. They didn't think they'd attack. Great player. The two of the guys that are being not mentioned are Murphy and Francis. These two are the two leaders in Pittsburgh right now. Francis and Murphy are 1-2 in league scoring, and no one even knows they're alive. Everyone, Jagr's getting all the press and Robitaille, but these guys are unbelievable players. Murphy, as I said before, and Francis are two of the most underrated players in the world.
And on cue, the three top playoff scorers are all on Pittsburgh. Look at that. Francis, 17 points. Murphy has a point in each of Pittsburgh's nine playoff games, and Jagr leads everybody with 10 goals in the playoffs. So Pittsburgh's got their guys scoring, but the defensive weaknesses may prove to be the key to the series.
I think they started showing up later in the game against the Devils, because I thought the Devils turned up their forechecking later in the game. You saw Stevens there. Earlier in the game, he had never done that. They were down. He put a little pressure on them, and they made mistakes. Get on them. Make them play in their end. Make them play under pressure. The Devils will like the results.
New Jersey and Pittsburgh tied it one game apiece, and game three is coming up on Wednesday. Coming up on our show, more on the Chicago-Vancouver series. But before we tell you about that, we got to tell you about tonight's question. And here is tonight's question. When was the first recorded tossing of an octopus onto the Detroit Red Wings ice surface? There it is. Read along with us. Study. Open your book. Key answer coming up.
Cam Neely, welcome to my workout. Let's start with a little scrimmage.
Hey, come on. One and two. Keep those elbows down. Remember to breathe. Now you want to get yourself right in front of the net. You know you're doing it correctly if you feel it right back in here. Oh. Let's head to the gym.
Move those legs.
Come on.
Pump it. Pump it.
To the ice.
Now, for a really good workout, try playing against a future Hall of Famer like Ray Bourque. If you don't have a Ray Bourque, just use whatever you have around the house.
Hi, I'm Tina. This is my baby. I feed her, nurture her, and I guide her. Believe me.
First, you're at
130 miles an hour, when she starts to whine, I'm a real mother.
Welcome back. Often we see the tossing of an octopus onto the Detroit Red Wings ice surface. Maybe you wonder how often this has gone on and why. So, there you see tonight's question. And the answer is April 15th, 1952, Game 4 of the Stanley Cup Finals between Detroit and Montreal. The eight legs on the octopus, by the way, represent the eight games it took for Detroit to win the Cup in 1952. Two sweeps to win the title 43 years ago. Game number two of Vancouver and Chicago. And, of course, one of the big stories, the goal by Jim Cummins, his first ever career playoff goal. He talked after the game with the guys who called the contest, Mike Goldberg and Brian Engblom.
Thank you, Bill Pito. Welcome back to Chicago. Brian, they say in the postseason that you will have many things contribute to a victory in a playoff series. Great defense, goaltending, and goals scored by unlikely sources. His first career playoff game-winning goal, Jim Cummins. Congratulations. Big victory for the Blackhawks.
It certainly is. You know, you win that game, it puts us up 2-0 instead of 1-1.
And Jim, you know, very excited. He had four goals in the regular season. He said he thinks he had one game winner then, Brian. Take us through the game winner, Jim, because it ended up coming early in the first period and ended up being all you needed with Eddie Belfour playing well.
Right, well, I got hit along the boards there and I kept the puck. I was coming around the net and I fed Eric Daze. He got a pretty good shot on net. I don't think the goalie got a handle on it, and I just came in front and chipped her in.
Did you feel this game was a lot different than game one from the standpoint of what Vancouver was trying to accomplish against you tonight, Jim?
Well, we knew they were going to come out ready. I mean, we have a lot of respect for this team. They're, you know, they went to the Stanley Cup final, so it was a little bit more physical. We knew they were going to come out physical, and we had to be ready, especially for their top players.
Well, the defensive system sure worked tonight. You allowed just 17 shots on Eddie Belfour and really seemed to stifle the Vancouver Canucks, especially in the neutral zone.
You know, we're trying to pay attention to their key players, and, you know, we got Eddie Belfour in net, and he just played great.
Well, star of the night, Jim Cummins, and nice to have Jeremy Roenick back in the lineup. Nice to get a victory in Game 2. That is the story from here in Chicago as the Blackhawks have taken a 2-0 series lead with a 2-0 victory tonight. Back to you, Bill Pito.
All right, guys, thank you very much. Cummins, a guy who happened to play with you in the AHL in Adirondack.
He was on the team that won the Calder Cup, and as I said, I was very happy for him. They got him near the deadline to supply muscle and character, which Jimmy does. He's also turned into a very good player. But what Mike Goldberg was saying, that in the playoffs, if you're going to go anywhere, you got to have people do things they don't normally do. You got to have your scorers check. You got to have your scorers hit people. And you got to have your fighters and your hitters score big goals. One of the biggest goals for my team in L.A. was Gary Tkachuk scoring a double overtime goal against Vancouver to eliminate them. So that's what winning is all about. People doing uncharacteristic things. Guys that aren't usually good defensively, playing great defense. Guys that are usually defensive specialists. Brown for Detroit scoring big goals, and that's winning hockey. And if you're going to win a Stanley Cup, you got to have that.
Chicago so far against Vancouver, 6-0 this year. That's something that, is it the matchup situation? I mean, it seems like Chicago, they're not dominating them in the playoffs. They did dominate the Canucks in the regular season. But so far this year, Chicago has completely wiped out Vancouver, at least in terms of wins and losses.
In the playoffs right now, they are dominating. Vancouver's not getting any offensive chances. They've only had maybe 7 or 8 great scoring chances. And again, I think it comes back to Vancouver right now. They're still playing back in that St. Louis series. They got to, Ricky Lee somehow has to get this team with a fire lit underneath them. He's got to do that the next couple days before the game in 2 days. They're not the same team right now. They're not the same emotional team. They haven't got the same fire, and they got to recapture that, or else Chicago's going to win this very quickly.
Chicago up 2-0. Coming up on NHL tonight, our 3 stars of the night, the guys who did best on this Tuesday night. We'll have those for you and much more when we come back after this.